My name is Max Feinstein, and I'm an anesthesia resident at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. In this video, we are diving into the wild world of Glaucomflecken to understand whether or not there actually exists an on-off switch for anesthesia, and why the description for this video that's been viewed 22 million times is nobody really knows what goes on back there. If you find this video interesting or helpful, I'd really appreciate it if you liked it and subscribed to the channel. Let's dive in. Before we get started, I do have to make the obligatory disclaimer that this video is not medical advice. It's a YouTube video. So if you need medical advice, talk to your doctor. If you're not one of the people who's contributed to the 22 million views that this video has received, let's go ahead and watch it. It's real quick and I'll get you up to speed on what we're talking about.
Hey doc, let me know when you got about 20 minutes left, okay?
Yeah, no problem. And we are done. Anesthesia, you can wake the patient up now. Is there a problem?
So you can't blame a surgeon for being focused on what they're doing, but a little bit of a heads up would have been nice.
What is it you think we do back here?
Well,
do you think we have a giant anesthesia on-off switch that allows the patient to wake up instantly?
No?
So this actually speaks to why I made this YouTube channel to begin with, because even among physicians, there's not really a great understanding of what exactly anesthesiologists do behind the curtain.
No.
Okay, take your time.
Thank you.
We done?
Yeah, so I mean, of course, we do have a literal button that we use to turn off the anesthesia, or a dial, depending on what anesthetic we're delivering. And the effect that we're going for is basically that a patient wakes up and is ready to go back to the recovery room as soon as the last suture is thrown. But the reality is a lot more complicated in terms of dosing the anesthetics and timing it for the end of surgery. To address the question of what anesthesiologists actually do, the number one priority, no matter what, is always keeping a patient safe while a procedure is going on. The second priority, in my opinion, is keeping a patient comfortable. And then another priority that falls somewhere after keeping a patient safe and comfortable is efficiently inducing anesthesia and emerging a patient from anesthesia in a way that's not going to delay the operating schedule. Efficiency is essentially the crux behind Glaucomflecken's video about the anesthesia on-off switch. One of the big challenges for anesthesiologists is that safety and comfort don't necessarily go hand in hand with efficiency. For example, general anesthesia is required for many different types of surgeries, and that involves a pretty significant depth of anesthesia and can often involve administering paralytics that reduce the amount of movement that a patient will make during surgery. The medications that are commonly used to provide general anesthesia have a tendency to accumulate in the body, and the longer that medication is given, well, the more that tends to accumulate. This concept is called a context-sensitive half-time, where context is the amount of time that an infusion or a medication has been administered, and half-time is the amount of time that it takes for the concentration of that medication to reduce in the blood by one half. From a practical clinical perspective, the sort of rule of thumb that I've heard is that for every hour that a propofol infusion is run, for example, it takes 10 minutes for that to wear off. In this example by Glaucomflecken, a 2-hour long surgery where propofol was used as the maintenance anesthetic agent might take about 20 minutes to wear off. So you can see why a 20-minute heads up is actually extremely accurate. So job well done, Glaucomflecken. The various volatile anesthetic gases like isoflurane, sevoflurane, and desflurane all accumulate to different extents in a patient's body during surgery and therefore take a varying amount of time in order for a patient to be rendered conscious again after the anesthesia has been turned off. For example, desflurane leaves a patient's body quite quickly and can lead to a pretty quick emergence, but there are also downsides that come along to the specific anesthetic agent, for example, harm to the environment, much more so than, say, sevoflurane. Generally speaking, there's nothing that we do in medicine that doesn't come without some downside, so picking out one anesthetic agent over another for the sake of efficiency may mean a trade-off in terms of something else, like cost or safety or damage to the environment. In addition to giving a patient an appropriate anesthetic depth, the anesthesiologist is also responsible for making sure that a patient's pain is well controlled, and that's very commonly done using an opioid like fentanyl or hydromorphone. But it's important to keep in mind that the administration of medications like opioids can serve to reduce a patient's level of consciousness, and that's especially true when combined with other agents like propofol or one of the anesthetic gases. That's something that can lead to an increased amount of time for a patient to emerge from anesthesia. So on the one hand, an anesthesiologist could go very light on the opioids and lead to a very quick emergence, but then it's pretty likely that a patient would wake up pretty uncomfortable. On the other hand, an anesthesiologist could give a lot of opioids and the patient would wake up comfortably, but it would just be a really extended wake-up period. On top of all of this, another complicating factor is the use of paralytics like rocuronium or vecuronium, which have a tendency to last for a while and are necessary for many different types of surgeries so that the surgical field can be still for the surgeon to operate. While there is a very rapid-acting reversal agent called Sugammadex that can be used for some of the neuromuscular blocking drugs, that also doesn't come without its risks, including a very small percentage of people who develop anaphylaxis to it, as well as the possibility for Sugammadex to render hormonal birth control unreliable for up to a week. And at least at the present time, it's a pretty expensive drug, clocking in somewhere around $100 to $200 per dose to be able to reverse a patient's neuromuscular blockade. The alternative reversal regimen that has been used for many years is neostigmine combined with glycopyrrolate, which can counteract some of the side effects of neostigmine. This is less expensive, but does take a while, like 10 or 15 minutes, in order to achieve its maximal effect. Just another reason why having a bit of a heads up before the end of surgery is going to be an important way to make sure that neuromuscular blocking drugs have been reversed and a patient is breathing appropriately before they're emerged from anesthesia. Taken all together, you can see that an anesthesiologist has to keep a patient safe, comfortable, and then make sure that they can efficiently go from a state where a patient is under general anesthesia, not aware of anything, not feeling any pain, and not moving, to a state where they are awake, breathing on their own, alert, and ready to leave the operating room right after the last suture has been thrown and the surgeon says that the surgery is all over. This is made all the more complicated by the fact that every patient is unique and differences like age, medical comorbidities, type of surgery, duration of surgery, and genetics, just to name a few characteristics, are all going to change the amount of time that it takes for a patient to emerge from anesthesia. So just because an anesthetic plan worked with perfect timing for one patient doesn't mean that it's necessarily going to work for the next patient, even if they're very similar in a lot of ways. With all that in mind, we can circle back to the question of how exactly do we turn off the anesthesia and make it seem like it's just a switch going off? It's really an illusion that can be accomplished a number of different ways, and I'll share several examples. One is simply having an awareness of how long it's going to be until the end of surgery and using your own experience to take an educated guess for how long it's going to take for a patient to emerge from anesthesia. I think it's reasonable in a lot of cases to say turn off a propofol infusion maybe 20 minutes before a surgery ends if the surgery's been 2 hours long and assuming that a patient has an appropriate amount of analgesics like opioids on board. This requires an excruciatingly high amount of vigilance to make sure that the patient shows no signs of being too light with anesthesia. And if they do appear to be coming light with their anesthesia as the last sutures are thrown, then the anesthesiologist needs to administer more medication, for example, a small bolus of propofol. Another technique that I commonly use for very long surgeries is to turn off the primary maintenance agent, which is the anesthetic that I've used to keep the patient under general anesthesia for the duration of surgery, and turn that off about an hour or so prior to the expected end of the surgical procedure. And then importantly, replace that with a different maintenance agent. Recall the concept of context-sensitive half-life, where a medication is going to take longer to have half of its plasma concentration, depending on how much time it's been administered for. So if I have a medication, for example, isoflurane, that I've been administering to a patient for 10 hours, and I expect that it might take an hour for that medication to wear off, then I'll turn the medication off an hour before the anticipated end of surgery and then start, for example, a propofol infusion. If the propofol infusion's only running for an hour, that may take 10 minutes or less to wear off. So then I can expect to be able to really finely dial in how much time it takes to emerge a patient, even if the surgery was very long, like a total of 11 hours. As a senior resident, reflecting back on the earlier portion of my anesthesia training, I recall having thought that the sign of a high-quality anesthesiologist was someone who could induce anesthesia very quickly and get through procedures like intubation and IV placement very quickly. And while that may be true, I've developed an even greater appreciation for anesthesiologists who can very quickly emerge a patient from anesthesia, particularly if it's been a very long surgery, and also making sure that a patient emerges very comfortably and in a very safe manner. If you enjoyed this video, check out this video I made where I go through some of the commonly used medications to deliver a general anesthetic. Thanks very much for watching. I'll see you next time.